Well, the exit interviews went well, Sarah. And basically what that is that's just to kind of, you know, let each one of them individually. And I met with everybody. And when I say everybody, don't ask me about the one, but I know you did. I met with everybody. And we just talked about the season and what we expect of them during the off season, and, kind of make sure that everything is set for the off season with them, and know that, we're here, and any kind of issues or anything come up, we're always here for them, and just to, let them know. And plus, I talked to them too about how I was appreciative of the way they stayed the course with me all year long, with all the ups and downs that we went through.
David, is there anything further that you can share with us about your future from what you told us different yesterday?
As far as I know, I'm the head coach of the Texans right now, and moving forward with that. Well, John, I hope they would and expect them to, but that, I'm not surprised with that. You know, they've been all in from the word go.
Have you spoken with Nick or Mr. McNair or Cal about your future then?
Not at all. And I will not speak to them. They'll speak to me.
Do you know when?
I haven't had anything scheduled.
Can you talk about your first year as a head coach, your first year experience?
I enjoyed every minute of it. Learned a lot. A lot of things, like I said before earlier, in that coaching manual I had to go through that wasn't in there, but that was okay, and I was told that was going to happen. But, again, from start to finish, each game was different. Always something new happening that was a learning experience for me. But for the most part, I just kind of used all the experience that I've got working with all the different head coaches, that all the situations they've been through, and I end up having to go through a bunch of those, and I just kind of use the stuff that I've learned from them to handle those particular situations. And other than that, I just kind of, as the season went along, you just kind of, any mistakes that you made that you feel like you really needed to maybe not do that or do this better, you make sure you do that the next time. Same thing with our players, as far as, look, don't be a repeat defender. And I was hoping I wasn't a repeat defender in some of the things that I did early that happened later on in the season. Well, we expect a big jump, Brooks. Very disappointed the fact that we only won 4 ball games. Expected to win more. Thought we should have won more. We didn't. But you always expect a big jump. And it's no different than with players, like the rookies. You expect a big jump for a rookie going into the second year, especially with the rookies that we've had that played a bunch. And it's the same way with this football team. We'll add some more pieces through the draft. And obviously, Nick will add some people through free agency. And we kind of know what we need to do to keep moving forward. Just looking forward to doing that.
You mentioned the exit interviews. A lot of guys that are on one-year contracts. That was partly intentional. How do you think that worked this year? What are we trying to do with that? How did that come up in the interview?
Well, I think it worked well because a lot of those guys that were on those contracts were veteran guys. That was very influential in keeping this locker room the way it was. And I felt like that having those guys here, whether they were on one-year contracts or what, I didn't even know exactly who was on 1 year or 2 years or whatever. I just coached whoever was there and treated it that way all year, never talked about it. But I do know that a lot of those veteran guys that we've had have been very influential in how things have gone for us this year. I respect that, and I'm glad that I had him here.
Have you had a chance to talk to Pat Hamilton about the interest from the Panthers and him? What do you think of him as a coach and as a candidate for job right?
Well, I think Pep and a number of guys on this staff are qualified to move on and become coordinators or head coaches.
Because of what we talked about, the one-year deal, how do you make sure that there's some consistency and it's not just you're back to where you were last year because there's so much turnover?
Well, there's going to be draft. There's going to be some guys that have been here with us this past year, Sarah, that were on one-year deals that may still be with us this year. And there's some continuity there because they've been in the program with us for a year. And that's where the continuity is going to come from. And we're just going to add to that. And I felt like after the bye week, I started to see that continuity with those guys that were here, whether they were on whatever their contract situation was. I started to see that continuity and continuity start to unfold for us. And I expect that moving forward with those guys that will be returning and for the guys that will be adding.
David,
Even though you didn't have the results maybe that we wanted, are you encouraged that y'all have laid a foundation that can lead to success in getting back into contention?
Very encouraged. Last night at the end of that ball game in the second half made me even more encouraged about just the way they went out and did what they did. And it wasn't anything that I did or said at halftime. They just went out and as pros and understanding the situation and played good football and gave us a chance to win a football game.
How did this experience challenge you as a leader?
I'm sorry, Brandon.
How did this experience as a first-year head coach challenge you as a leader? Did you learn anything about yourself, and what do you feel like you improved at?
Brandon, I knew there were going to be challenges when I first came here. And again, I've told people this, and not in a negative way. You know, if everything was all right before I got here, I wouldn't be here. So the point was, I knew going in there were going to be things that I'd have to deal with and that we dealt with. And I felt like, again, because of my experience that I've been with some very good head coaches, have gone through some things that were similar to this when we were building the program. And those things helped me along the way. But there wasn't anything that I think that happened during the course of the year that I haven't seen happen before or something similar that I kind of had an idea of how I wanted to deal with that or how I should deal with that.
David, building off that, do you feel like you've got better?
Brandon, most definitely. Most definitely. I mean, I go back and I'm as hard on myself as anybody from that standpoint because of my responsibility to this football team. And with them being the leader of this football team and them looking to me when to get things right when they're not right. And I felt like that they had the utmost confidence in me to do that simply because, you know, when those things came up, we corrected things and we went forward. And
David, building off that situation you inherited, how fair do you think it is to judge you up 1 year of results?
Well, I mean, you're judged every year. And basically, you're judged on wins and losses. And if you judge it on wins and losses, I'm not happy with four wins at all. You know, I expected to get more than four wins and felt like we should have got more than four wins. But this is a bottom line business. And, you know, I wasn't happy with the number of wins we got, but I expect to get more.
Before the season, Nick was telling us about how this, he was like, I don't want to put it in my mouth, but this is not necessarily going to be results oriented. It's more process oriented. Did you have a conversation with him maybe when you were hired or before the season? Were you
kind of
set what the expectations were?
No, the expectations was to win as many football games as possible. That we went in with that. We knew the situation with all the new people coming in, but the expectations was to go out and win. This is the NFL, Sarah, and you know, you're expected to go out and win. And I've said this all the time, and I say it to our players. The beauty of coaching in the National Football League, that any given Sunday thing is so true. If you play the game right, that particular day, and it doesn't matter who the opponent is. And I don't mean this negatively, but the example of yesterday, the Indianapolis coach playing Jacksonville in Jacksonville with the win or end game. I'm not surprised that Jacksonville won the game. They played better, you know, and that's what happens in this league. It doesn't matter who you play. If you play better than the opponent that you're playing against and play the game the right way, you'll have a chance to win, and it doesn't matter who it is you're playing.
David, how is it for you that there's questions about your status after just 1 year?
I don't even think about questions about my status, Mark.
Can you talk about football a long time? What did you learn this year about the game, being in this position, or about yourself?
Well, the first thing was that I used to always make suggestions, and I had to make decisions right now, you know, this time. And when I made those decisions, that decisions affected a whole bunch of people and affected an entire football team. And I learned that before I made those decisions, or whatever they might have been, that I had to see the big picture. It wasn't about a particular guy, or it wasn't about a particular coach. It was about the football team. And that's the big thing as far as me making decisions, is being able to understand that every decision you make affects what happens with this football team.
You say you talked to all the players. I mean, what were some of the things that maybe that were unexpected that they said, and the things that you could build on through the offseason that they suggested that might help?
Well, all of those conversations, Brooks, were positive. And basically those conversations are, for the most part, between me and them with that. But they were all positive. And it's always a good thing at the end of the year when you have these. I've had these before, but I only had them with a position group. And it's always a positive thing.
With the offense, we talked about penalties and turnovers, taking care of the ball.
Mm-hmm.
But struggling offensively this year, and we talked about Tim Culley and everything. What needs to happen for the offense to sort of take a step and be, you know, productive, at least, you know, top half offense?
Yeah, we've got to coach that better. And I think, too, as we went along, we kind of found out, too, that obviously I want to run the football. We weren't able to run the football very well. Obviously, there's different reasons why that happens. That has nothing to do with Tim or the play caller. But the point we find out was, as we went along, was is that, you know, there are times when probably the best thing for us to do would be to throw the ball in these particular situations more. A good example of that is just making adjustments. And yesterday was a classic example of that. We weren't very good in the first half of that ball game, and my gut feeling was we got to change up something. I didn't know what, but and the thing was the tempo. Well, I found out that obviously, probably I look back on it, that there were times when I probably should have used the tempo in some of these other ball games that I had before. And I guess you asked me earlier about what did I learn about that. Those are some of the things that I've learned, that as I make decisions and you go back and you say, that's something that maybe I should have done earlier.
I want to ask you how much did Davis's development and what he revealed to you guys over the course of the season?
It contributes a lot. And Brandon, and as I said before yesterday, the guy has been very good in two-minute situations when we didn't huddle and when the clock wasn't an issue. And he did a very, very good job of it. He commanded everything. Tim was still calling plays into him. He was making the checks. He was doing everything that we needed to do. And that's just something that he's actually done very well when he was at Stanford. But I'm happy with his progress, and I think we found out something about him that moving forward, that's something that we can do to help us offensively, because that's something that he was comfortable with and did it very well against a very good football team in a very, very big ball game.
You said in the second half, whenever you went up to – you said in the second half you went up to Mills and asked him if he was ready to go up tempo and if he could do that.
Well, I actually – Brooks already made the decision to do it. I was just kind of – making sure it was, you know, he if he'd have said he wasn't ready, I said, well, you better get ready because we're doing it, you know.
Were there times earlier in the year where he wasn't quite ready for that, and was there a moment where you feel comfortable that, okay, we could do that?
No, I don't think there was ever any moments that that I felt like he would have been uncomfortable to why I didn't do it. It was just something that I didn't think about doing at that time, you know. But, you know, with him, I mean, when I went up to him and told him that's what we were going to do, his eyes lit up like, okay, you know, he knew we needed to make a change. He knew we needed to do something else to get ourselves going. Oh, I don't give grades, you know. And he said, I'll let the hire-to-bes give me the grade. We would take a little break. As a matter of fact, we just talked to our team about, you know, you need to get away for a little while. You need to recharge and refresh, you know. Whether we were 12-4 or 4-12 or whatever the record was, you know, you got to get away and get recharged and get refreshed, and we'll do that. As coaches, we don't do it for very long, but we do it. And, you know, I'm not going to leave the country, you know, to refresh or do something, you know. I'm just going to chill, you know. I do know that I don't watch a whole bunch of football when I do that, simply because it's kind of frustrating when you know that, you know, there's a possibility that it could be you, but for the most part, you know, we'll just recharge. And then when we come back, we'll start our self-scout. We'll start the off-season. We'll start with free agency. We'll get ready for the draft. It never ends.
So you'll go to Friday movies to maybe every other day?
Now, I don't know, sir, if I go every other day, but if there's a good movie coming out, I mean, I'll go see it because I got time now. And I'm not as tired now. And I'm not having to worry about that opponent on Sunday. I loved every minute of it, Mark. I mean, every minute. I did not like the losses. Nobody likes the losses, but I love this job. And again, like you said, I don't consider this work. You know, I know sometimes whenever you don't win enough ball games, people say, and I have people talking about like they're feeling sorry for me. They feel sorry for me. Do you know what I do? I'm the head coach of the Houston Texans, you know, regardless of what the record is. And that's a beautiful thing.
Last one, Brooks. Rest of your coaching staff, do you have a timeline or expectation of when they'll know what their future is?
Well, as far as I'm concerned, their future is now. They're here, and they'll be coaching with me.
Okay, thanks, Coach.
You got it. You're welcome.